How are you doing?
Hey, great to be with you guys. And the creator of the multiverse.
You were the one that pitched the show when you gave me the phone call. Yeah, you were like, I got this idea for a show. Would you want to host it? And it was blown away, of course. Yeah.
Well, of course, you understood that I don't know anything about the multiverse. I just thought,
that's where I come
in. I like the word, right? It's a cool word.
It is a cool word.
What do you know about physics? It's cool.
Yeah.
It's cool.
Well, and that's what's amazing about it. And now Tom has written a new book with Carl Gallups and Lieutenant Bob McGinnis, excuse me. And viewers of Into the Multiverse have seen them in previous programs, always do really well. We also have my lovely, beautiful wife, Christina Peck. How are you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
Doing great.
Awesome.
Let's jump right in. Saboteurs, with a subtitle too long for me to memorize. So. But of course, readers of yours are probably used to that. But Saboteurs, this is a fascinating book and really something timely for what we see in the political arena today. Because usually when we watch things on news, we get the politics end of it, but rarely ever, really not at all, do we ever get the spiritual end of it. Mm-hmm. This is something that you Bob McGinnis and Carl Gallups have dealt with. What led to this book?
Yeah, well, of course, you know, the election of Donald Trump. Mm-hmm. And I have to say that I was more excited about doing this research in particular than any project I've worked on for probably 10 years.
Right.
All the way back maybe 2007, 8, something like that. And the reason was there was some very compelling things, we can get into a little bit of this, in the WikiLeaks.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Right? That indicated a very high sorceress level of occultism. Satanism basically is happening with very powerful people in Washington, D.C. So I was alerted to that. And of course, then just noticing, you know, the deep state, the shadow government, the cross-party manipulation of Washington, D.C. establishment that continues, right? Very unhappy with the election of Donald Trump. It was never supposed to happen. His Make America Great Again. You know, even his style, he's an outsider. And what did Newt Gingrich say? He said he's not a member of the secret society, right?
Yeah.
He's not supposed to be here. He doesn't know the secret handshake.
Right. And
he's
we don't think that was just euphemism or metaphor. Like, that was likely literal.
Mm-hmm. I think it absolutely was literal. And especially by the time people read the book Saboteurs, in fact, for some people, that book's going to be a little bit scary.
Mm-hmm.
And I've been even telling people, this is not a book to give to your little kids,
right?
To read, because there is some very intense information in the book.
Mm-hmm.
But it really is talking about what is the underbelly in Washington, D.C. If you get past the fact that you have the federal bureaucracy, you have the lifelong, you know, fat cats that work in Washington, D.C., that work with lobbyists, and they're all in each other's back pockets, and they're all deal makers, and they want to protect their own establishment, right? Their jobs, their careers, their investments in oil, I mean, everything. They're trading internationally, they're globalists in mindset. They hate the idea of we're going to build a wall. They don't. They want to tear down all the walls. They want this to be really, you know, kind of a globalist new Europe, but here, I guess, right?
Okay.
But behind that is where I think the real sources of power are emanating from an ancient empire, from an ancient entity. It's Luciferian in scale. And really, it's been an objective since the founding of the country that we are going to establish a new form of democracy. Based really on the Atlantean scheme from Francis Bacon and early Freemasons in the United States.
But I thought we were founded as a Christian nation. Yeah. What's the deal?
Well, the founding fathers themselves say we were not founded as a Christian nation.
Right.
Some of them, Thomas Paine, others, went out of their way to actually ridicule the Bible. They talked about the Bible as a dung heap. Mm-hmm. That's their words, not mine. Thomas Jefferson so rejected the divinity of Christ that he took a Bible and cut out every place in the Bible where it spoke of the divinity of Christ. You put the Smithsonian puts that on display every once in a while. It's literally called the Jefferson Bible. Now some of these guys, you know, as deists and Freemasons, They knew they had to work with the Christian segment of this country, which was growing from the Pilgrim movement and forward. And so they were friendly. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we've talked before about how you can go into the house of the temple, the headquarters of the Scottish Rite Freemasonry, 33rd degree in Washington, D.C., go up to the third floor to the temple room and the giant altar there. It's got all kinds of holy books. It's got the, you know, the Quran, and it's got the Buddhist text. It's got all that on it. It's also got a Bible on it, right? So they recognize the need to be able to appreciate people of faith, and they also admittedly see a lot of good in a lot of the Christian ethics, the idea of individual liberties and the freedom of speech and so many of the other things on which the Constitution and the Bill of Rights were based, and the universities that were first built here that have a lot of the elements from the Bible in them, right? So they recognize that as part of a foundational need to be able to govern people whose this was their faith. You had to appreciate where they were coming from. You couldn't be hostile to it.
Right.
But
right.
it didn't typify what they themselves actually believed.
So it's kind of like let's appease the Christians on the surface so we can do all this dark stuff behind the scenes. Was it kind of?
Yeah, I've heard stories of like because they have all those holy books there that it's basically we'll appease your God, you know, whatever you believe, but it's not exactly, that's just the surface. It's something much darker underneath all of it.
Well, it's also more universalist in the sense that they believe if you're talking about Jesus Christ, you're also talking about Osiris.
Right.
You're also talking about, you know, any of these other spiritual entities, right? Helena Blavatsky, or however you say her name, right? The Ascended Masters, right? Which was Buddha, Jesus, she mentions. So it's more that today in our modern culture, we'd call it the New Age.
Yeah.
Spiritualism, spiritism. And so they had an appreciation for that. But if you're standing there inside the temple room looking at all these Bibles and stuff, look up. Stand right there and look straight up. There's a magic 666 square right above the altar that was used in antiquity for raising the spirit of Apollo.
Oh.
And this is really where they're coming from. If you look at the prophecy on the Great Seal, the Novus Ordo Seclorum, the Anoet Coeptus, these are all taken from the prophecies of the Cume Sibyl, who talks about at the end of time, Apollo is going to return to be the king on earth while his father takes over the heavens once again in the dawn of a new golden age. That was really what they were committed to. And so it is lip service, but it's also they believe that the spirit that filled Jesus Christ is the same spirit that's going to fill Apollo. So it's a scarier, darker, twisted kind of universalism.
Wow. So continuing where we left off, you were talking about this new universalism. Where is this going to lead?
Well, ultimately, where it leads, if you're a hardcore believer and you practice the kind of ancient mysticism, it's both the Egyptian and also elements of Greek religion, they believe that we are moving towards the dawn of a new golden age, the Novus Ordo Seclorum, right? The dawn of a new age. And interestingly, another part of their tenet, an occult idea that's called Ordo Ab Chao, order out of chaos, is that you have to create elements of chaos like you would see playing out in the streets today in the opposition to the Trump ideas that are, we're going to make Christianity great again, we're going to be pro-Israel. You have to create chaos in the street.
Well, we've definitely seen that.
Yeah, and so that's being engineered by enemies of democracy, of true democracy.
It's people like George Soros, those type.
Well, and Obama, look, Obama moves, you know, 1 mile away from the White House, opens his own, the second White House. I don't know what we call this, right? But even in the Beltway, they're calling this a pseudo third-term presidency, a shadow government. And yet, what has he done? He's returned to his Saul Alinsky roots, right?
Right.
Where he was at one time a community organizer. That's what they do. They organize these events in the streets in order to create protests. Well, if you follow Saul Alinsky, who was a 60s radical, if you read his book, Rules for Radicals, what does he say? He says, you have to create unrest. You have to give people a sense that something is wrong, right? And they've got to protest against it, and you've got to make them feel empty, and you got to make them feel afraid. And he goes into all of how you're going to do this, but who does he dedicate his book, Rules for Radicals, to? Lucifer, the first original radical. So at the core of it, again, that's what the book Saboteurs is doing. It's saying, yeah, all of this stuff is happening. It's all playing out on CNN and Fox News and whatever, right? But it was Newt Gingrich who really got more to the core of the matter when he said the problem with this guy is he is not part of the secret society.
Right.
He hasn't been to, you know, to the Redwood Forest in California to get down in front of a 40-foot tall giant owl.
Right.
He's not part of the club. And so there is a very real occult aspect to this. Now, where's it going, to answer your question? If you look at Washington, D.C., and the layout of Washington, D.C., and on another program, I'll repeat this, but people need to go to our own Library of Congress website and read an article that's published on our own government official website called the Most Perfect Plan, the Most Approved Plan. And it's the idea that before the capital city was laid out, they advertised all these engineering firms in early America, also other countries, France, Europe, for big engineering firms to design what Washington, D.C. would look like. And a lot of people submitted and were, you know, somebody's supposed to win the contest, right?
Right.
But the Most Approved Plan on the Library of Congress website says that all the plans were rejected by Washington and especially Jefferson. Why? Because Jefferson wanted to shepherd a plan that would cause the U.S. capital city to be based on the old Roman pantheon and dedicated to all pagan gods. And that's the reason why it's laid out the way it is. You stand in the Washington Mall, you're looking at a giant obelisk right out of Egypt, right? What is this thing doing here? And the U.S. Capitol Dome, the belly of Isis. Go inside the U.S. Capitol Dome and look up. What do you see? The apotheosis of George Washington, the famous painting by Brumidi.
And it's not a Christian heaven scene that's up there.
Apotheosis means to become a god. What god is he becoming? The official records say Osiris, right? This is the prophecy on the Great Seal, Osiris Apollo. And you're right, it's not a, there are no Christian elements at all in the heaven that George Washington is rising into. It's all pagan gods and demons, including the god Vulcan, who Manly P. Hall says fills the Freemasons' hands with the seething energies of Lucifer.
Oh, great.
Right below that are 72 pentagrams. That's a Pythagorean binding utility. Occultists know what that is. That's meant for controlling the 72 cosmocrators that you and Dr. Michael Heiser and Derek Gilbert have talked so much about. Also, why, though, Jesus sent out 72 disciples, because he was showing that he had come to reverse the curse of the watchers, right? So, but yeah, so you've got this binding utility. So then what happens? Well, in ancient Egypt, during the festival of Opet, they would take the pharaoh, put him on a barge, take him up the Nile River. When he was a brand new pharaoh, the laity would walk along on both sides of the Nile River, playing out these festivals and plays based on the legend of Osiris and Isis. He gets to the Temple of Amun-Ra. This is part of the largest temple construction ever built in Karnak. And he goes inside the ever-pregnant belly of Isis, the Temple of Isis. He's looking out at the obelisk. The Egyptian magicians perform the raising of Osiris ceremony to draw up the seat of Osiris through the base of the obelisk, magically emits into the belly of Isis, right? And he's transmogrified. He becomes the living Osiris. And then he comes out of the temple. All of Egypt celebrates because now they have divine representation. Fast forward to today. At the inauguration of every American president, while they're standing in the U.S. Capitol Dome, beneath the first Osiris, Washington, with the 72 binding pentagram binding utility beneath the pagan heaven, as he's standing there looking out at the largest obelisk of its kind in the world. It's 6666 inches high. It's 666 inches long, each perimeter of the base, right? As he's looking at that, across town at the House of the Temple, what are the modern Egyptian magicians doing? They're conducting the raising of Osiris ceremony in a parody, I guess, that assumes that the spirit of Osiris is coming into this president just like it came into the first U.S. president, who has gone on to become the Osiris in the underworld, but this one is becoming the living divine representation on earth today. But they're doing this in anticipation of the day when the spirit of Apollo, Osiris, is going to rise up out of the underworld and actually become incarnate in a U.S. president who, and by the way, Roosevelt, President Roosevelt, and his VP, Henry Wallace. Henry Wallace wrote about this. It's in his own biography where he says that both of them, as Freemasons, believed that the prophecy on the Great Seal of the United States was a Masonic prophecy that forecast the day when a U.S. president would become the king of Earth, the leader of the world, right at the dawn of a new golden pagan age. Well, why should Christians care anything about this? Because this is exactly what the book of Revelation says.
Right.
It says the beast will rise up out of the bottomless pit and go into perdition. And that's the Greek word Apollo, Apollyon, right? The Apostle Paul says of the Antichrist, he will be the son of perdition. Mm-hmm. That's what Horus, the son of Osiris, right? Yeah. That's what all this mythology is based on. He will become the son of perdition, Apollyon, Apollyon, Apollo. And so behind the deep state and the shadow government and everything else, and don't forget, Obama was the first president in American history to also have a Freemasonic ball held in his honor, right? So all these people communicate with each other. They're all giving their tells away for people to understand the sorcery that's behind this.
So it's not just some antiquated, you know, dead religion or anything. This is still active now and is actually affecting the course of Washington in big ways. Something I'm curious about, is there any evidence that anything like that happened at Trump's inauguration?
Well, I don't think. You know, Trump obviously would not be celebrating the idea that some, but they all go through the same process. And by the way, this is where heads of state are taken when they die. They're put in their casket and they're brought inside that area. And mysticism is based on, you know, the reason why they're, what do you call it, you know, when you have a viewing time over somebody's grave or whatever.
Like a wake or something like that. Yeah.
That's why that all happens inside this magic utility, right? It's an ancient utility, the purpose of which was specifically designed to draw up the seed of Osiris from the underworld for the purposes of incarnation. So is there any other evidence? Now fast forward to the WikiLeaks scandals, right? And you and Derek Gilbert have a book coming out towards the end of this year called The Day the Earth Stands Still.
Yes, sir.
And it's based on contiguous aliens and all the stuff that was revealed. We discovered that, you know, Hillary's campaign manager, John Podesta, and his brother Tony Podesta and Marina Abramović, or however she says her name, right?
Probably close enough.
Yeah, I mean they're exchanging emails about conducting spirit cooking sessions. This is right out of the Liber of Aleister Crowley. This is some of the darkest occultism. But what is the purpose of it? It's directly connected to opening doorways, portals, metaphysical gateways to put yourself into communication with that king of the underworld, right? Apollyon. In fact, in the 1940s, they conducted the Babylon workings.
Right.
The whole purpose of which was to bring through the archetype divine feminine, the whore of Babylon, right? And you can see in the emails that the people around Hillary believed, still believe, I think, that she is the incarnation of that sex magic that was happening in the 40s, because she's born in the exact year that Jack Parsons said a female that would go on to become an internationally acclaimed feminist, right? Same year she was born. And then in 69 years ago, right, 1948, when this female child would have been 1 year old, when Hillary was 1 year old, he writes a little book called Book of the Antichrist. And in it, he says that the spirit of this one-year-old child came to him, told him it's doing fine, it's going to grow up, it's going to help the Antichrist come to power, right? And also told him its name. She said, I am Hilarion, which is the arcane Hillary. So I'm telling you, whether or not Hillary believes any of that, and we know that Hillary has practiced, you know, communicating with the dead, Eleanor Roosevelt, that kind of thing. We know that. And also voodoo. In fact, in her brand new book, Hillary talks about how she wanted to use voodoo to cast voodoo spells on some of the people. So we know that she's at least on the fringe of some of this, you know, witchcraft or whatever. Whether she believes she's the Hilarion, I don't know. But it is very obvious the people around her did. And again, these people are connected and Freemasons, mm-hmm. who are connected to the house of the temple, who are conducting these rituals. So they certainly believe that a day is coming in which America is going to take its rightful position on earth as the government over the golden pagan age.
Wow. Well, we have just barely scratched the surface. Unfortunately, we are out of time. We're actually a little over time, but that's always a good thing.
Yes.
It's always good to have too much rather than too little. The book is Saboteurs, Dr. Thomas Horn. Well, I just not enough good could be said, really. And I hope people will stay tuned to Skywatch TV, because actually one of the coolest things about this show is we've developed an audience who aren't really familiar with Skywatch TV. You know, of course, there's some overlap. A lot of our audience came from Skywatch TV, but since that time, there are people who aren't familiar. So if you're interested in this, if you like this episode and want a lot more information, of course, pick up the book. But check out Skywatch TV. We have 5 network programs coming up, a bunch of web-exclusive content. You'll be able to find all that at skywatchtv.com and youtube.com/skywatchtv_official.
There you go.
It is a mouthful. Well, Tom, again, I can't thank you enough for coming on the show. This has been a blast.
Hey, thank you for having me on.
Anytime.